Okay, so welcome back, everyone. Found my way back onto the planks, and that's really all you need to do to succeed here in the swamp in 3-2. Because once you're up here, it's mostly a straightforward path. There are a few twists and turns, but they quickly spill off into a dead end, and it's easy to find your way back to the main path. Easy to find your way around for the most part. It's just once you go off exploring, you can sometimes lose the, I think there are 2 or 3 ramps that lead back up here. Also, I don't think this is quite the cliffside. In Pure Black World Tendency, this is where the primeval demon for World 3 is. This general area, you find him in the swamp off of one of the outlets from the plank bridge. Wait, which way am I going? Okay, never mind. Never mind that question. The mini ones are more just pests than anything. I kind of wish they weren't here. I believe it's left, and I'm gonna say another left. Yeah, I see the fog gate. Took a lot of brain power to figure out. Fog gate is the right direction. I am a scholar. Life's going better for me right now than it is for these guys. Man, that's a really dismal thing to say. It's like, man, life is going so shitty right now. Sarcastic bullshit. No, nothing has changed between this episode and the last episode that warrants that kind of bleak bullshit. Oh man, this is just silly. We have fun here. We have fun. We like to have fun. Do you like to have fun? I don't know what the fuck I'm talking about. Oh god. Let's get through this small gate. Oh, my head hurts now. You ever laugh in one of those very weird, breathy ways and it just saps all of the oxygen directly out of your brain? Oh, I'm losing brain cells now. If it was not already evident, those brain cells are just evaporating. Whatever, I don't know what the hell happened in the transition between last episode to now. Whatever it was similar to what I imagine Mike experiences whenever he drinks Gatorade. Oh, the Black Phantom Octopus Guard. Don't like these guys, so I'm gonna go ahead and equip the Thief Ring. So hopefully I can sneak up on it and not get killed. I don't like when the Octopus Guards French me normally. I especially don't like it when they are Black Phantom Guards, because they are much more deadly. But that went pretty well, aside from the fact that I didn't get the backstab I wanted. Like, the whole point of sneaking up on them is to get the one-hit kill backstab. I don't know if I would have one-shot at him. But... Oh, you bitch. Why do you interrupt me? Why do you interrupt me like that, Manipede? It's very rude. I'm your guest here in Lotteria, Manipede. Manipede. Don't do that, Manipede. Come back. Come back, Manipede. I didn't mean to hurt your feelings. It's just, you know, sometimes I get really on edge. I have to take my frustration out. You know, it's a coping mechanism. You just kick the dog. Or in this case, the Manipede, but... Manipede, I didn't mean to call you a dog. Come on, Manipede. Don't be like that. Jesus Christ. That crystal lizard up ahead. You can get him, but he, as you can see, is a trap. I am choosing not to pursue him because this guy back here... if you choose to pursue the crystal lizard, you will usually have, I think, at least 3 or 4 of these guys following you. Because by the time you actually catch up to the lizard, I think there are 2 more of the centipedes up ahead. This, I think, is a stone or a soul. Old Spice. Old Spice is so powerful it can power your overpowered ass soul hours for up to 15 hours! Okay. Yeah, I'll just keep munching away on the crescent moon grass. It's not the most efficient use of time to use the crescent moon grass, but it's way better than wasting the big grass when you don't need that emergency big heal. Might as well just take a few extra seconds, munch away on that crescent moon grass when you're out of combat and when you're not in immediate danger. That way you have more of the big grass for emergency situations. Oh, I see you, Gargoyle. I just want you to come down. I just want you to fly down here. There we go. That wasn't so hard. Now, wasn't... Still have the asshole crossbow gargoyle behind him, backing him up. I just want to lead him back and stab him. I feel like I'm in a Bob Ross painting video right now for some reason. We're just going to put a nice, happy little blade right there through his abdomen. And if he still comes at us with his friend the archer, then we'll be happy to just provide him some nice soothing warmth in the form of this flaming sword that we have. Yeah, we'll just get it right up in his sternum. And then he'll be warm for a very long time. When he's burning in hell. And with the sound of that elevator in the distance, that is keying us into the fact that we are almost done with this section of the level. We just have this is a much, much longer elevator ride that we have to wait for. It is the second of the two chains that we need to break. So, after we do that, we can get on with the boss fight, because it's just a hop, skip, and a jump away after that. I'm going to cut out a bit of backtracking after I release this second chain. There is just a little bit to be done. The backtracking that I'm going to be doing is I'm going to go down to that top, that spiral staircase where the heart was blocking us from accessing an area earlier, towards the beginning of the level. And then after that, I will move on to doing Maneaters and the old monk boss fight. Should have plenty of time to fit those in this episode. So in the meantime, let's murder some, converted prisoners / colluding cultists / alliterative phrase that I can't conjure up right now. Okay, well, decided to just cut a bunch of backtracking out, because we don't need that shit. We just need to keep coming down here. Isn't that right? Isn't that right, Gargoyle? You're my little traveling buddy. Now, we can go... You bastard. So you can see now that we've lowered the heart and dropped that down, the area has been flooded with man centipedes who crawled out of the heart. It's a really nice, disturbing little image there. But it's okay. It's not a big deal. We can deal with them pretty easily. I would like it if the gargoyle would come down, but it's not a big deal. You can just chill up there all day. It's not going to be a big deal. Come on, get it out of your system. There we go, little guy. I don't know why I am talking to these monsters in this episode as if they are like family members, as if they're like my spouse, my child. Developing like really, really disturbing relationships with these enemies. So at the bottom of the heart pit here, we find a bunch of really interesting items. We find the Ring of Avarice, the rapier, the golden mask, and a few other items. And it looks like this pit might have been where Yurt was disposing of the bodies of a bunch of Soul Society members he murdered. The item descriptions all indicate they belong to the Soul Society. They were members or something along those lines. And there are multiple Soul Society corpses, and Yurt is here to murder members of the Soul Society. Now, what they were doing here imprisoned in Latria is an interesting question. It's possible they were not imprisoned, but they were willfully helping the new ownership or the new management with their experimentation by providing souls to fuel the experiments. It's possible they were not in fact imprisoned, but colluding. And that's how Yurt stumbled upon them. Otherwise, they were maybe part of the Latrian nobility. Perhaps they were in fact imprisoned, but then Yurt would have had to have freed them first. And we unfortunately have to do the rest of this episode in post-commentary. This is obviously it's the same character, it's a much, much later New Game Plus playthrough. And this little montage is when I was playing through initially, the several times that I fell to my death fighting the Maneater fight, or the Maneater bosses. I think it took me 5 tries to do this boss initially. That's not why I'm doing post-commentary. It took me 5 tries to do this boss because I kept doing stupid things that resulted in me rolling to my death. The reason that the rest of this episode has to be in post-commentary is because I think you saw a few little minor blips, visual distortion. So, as you can see, the fight starts off with just one Maneater. And he has a lot of attacks. He has, on the ground, he can do that charging pounce attack. It's very fast, it hits fairly hard, it will drain all of your stamina. He has the attack he's just used twice, which is the same thing that the Octopus Guards have, kind of. It's that big sound wave projectile attack. And the way you deal with it is you take one step back when he casts it, because it always moves directly to where you're standing when he casts. He also has 2 different ground pound abilities with his fists. He has something that you saw in the very beginning of the fight where he glows yellow, and the snake tail he has pinches his neck. It gives him, I think, a 50% damage boost, which makes him even more dangerous. When he's in the air, he can do, I think, a soul arrow attack, a homing soul arrow. He doesn't seem to want to do it. He spends a lot of his time just flying around derpy-like in the air. One of the most dangerous things about this fight, though, as you saw in the me dying several times, is the environment itself. It's not a very nice place to fight him. It's not a big arena, and most of his attacks require rolling, especially his 2 most dangerous melee attacks, the pounce and the attack where he slams his fist into the ground. This is the other thing that makes the fight very dangerous and very difficult for some people, is that I think it's about a minute in, maybe 2 minutes, or when he hits, I want to say it's 30% of his health, another Maneater swoops in. And you're stuck fighting 2 of them at once. And this one, I happen to be taking the first Maneater very slowly. So the first Maneater is still has over 60% of his health, while the second Maneaters have full health and active. You can cut their tails off, which reduces their ability to do the very dangerous power-up move. Or rather, it eliminates it. But the fight can still be very difficult to manage. I take a lot of unnecessary damage from the Maneaters because A, I'm actually confident in what will or will not kill me in this fight, unlike with Flame Lurker, where it was just me being frantic and sucking. And B, because I'm usually too scared to roll. Maneaters are also way less aggressive, so eating the hit with your shield and losing all your stamina usually doesn't leave you as vulnerable to follow-ups, so I would rather risk taking some damage or losing all of my stamina and being guard broken to not screwing up a roll and falling to my death. It's also why you see me playing so carefully and sticking to this area with a brazier. You can approach this fight more aggressively and do a lot of rolling and countering and shit, but I'm not confident enough to fight the Maneaters like that, so I'll happily just be a patient, successful coward than a brave corpse. The tricky thing is that the walkway on either side, they're both very narrow, and I constantly forget he can do the charge attack right through the brazier, which is counterintuitive, and even in the more open middle area, you don't have a whole lot of room to dodge around, and if the camera swings while you're just inputting the roll, you can roll the wrong direction and go off the cliff. Ideally, you would break lock on and roll with the camera in a fixed direction, but that can be kind of tricky and a little bit finicky, especially in the pattern of like lock on, attack, break lock, roll, in the time it takes one of the Maneaters to charge his pounce attack. It's really fast. So, like I said, it's not like it's terribly difficult to dodge the attacks, but if the camera suddenly turns around, you'll roll the opposite direction you intended and go off the edge a lot of the times, rather than away from it. And it's too long of a fight to risk an instant death. It's one of those risk versus reward situations. You know, there's cost-benefit analyses where the things I'm weighing are a few pieces of grass versus a long run back and a refight against making the fight go slightly quicker. And it works out in that I would rather just play very, very slowly, very cowardly, and just take the hits where I can get them. Faster weapons, by the way, are also way, way more favorable in this fight, as is fire damage and I think magic damage in general. Firestorm is especially good for a spell if you have the memory slots for it, and yeah, that's pretty much it. If you have the MP, you can chain cast it by this point if you've gotten enough old spice or fresh spice. Those options just provide way more reliable damage. It also helps to have ranged options available for when they're being stubborn and not fighting you where you want them to. I used the Dragonbone Smasher and had very little magic throughout several playthroughs with this character, as you can see. So those options weren't terribly effective. I think by this playthrough, my DBS is +5 at least, so that helps. This is like, I can't remember if this is New Game +++ or New Game +4. Insanity Catalyst with a light weapon for an enchant on a blue blood sword is pretty insane if you want speed, and you do want speed on this fight, ideally anyway. I like my Dragonbone Smasher too much. I could min-max and end this really quick or whatever, but like I said way back in the beginning, I'm not going to be min-maxing. I'm not going to go crazy agonizing over builds. And that's less like a choice for the Let's Play and more just how I like to approach RPGs in general. I'm not like a huge fan of min-maxing usually. I like to just improvise and do what feels good in the moment. And the decision to min-max is still... It can be really interesting, though, because you're essentially weighing what you get out of min-maxing with losing the agency of just being able to do whatever. Like in Demon Souls, I don't min-max because I don't get enough out of it. It's not a worthwhile trade for cleaner, faster boss kills to plan things out meticulously and limit myself to certain more optimal strategies and builds. I like my big, dumb, heavy Dragonbone Smasher. It's tons of fun to use, even if it's not the ideal weapon for the fight. On the other hand, take something like raiding in World of Warcraft. For heroic raids, you kind of have to be min-maxed. Like, you have to play a certain spec with a certain rotation of spells and abilities, with certain gear and prioritizations of certain stats to optimize yourself, because heroic bosses are tuned around min-maxing. But the reward for losing agency over how you build your character is that you get to experience more challenging, more interesting content in the form of heroic raids. So it's a worthwhile trade-off. Anyway, that diatribe on min-maxing got a little out of hand, and I lost track of how it relates to Demon's Souls. I guess the underlying point of that is this. Min-maxing just for the sake of doing so is pointless. If it gives you access to something that offsets the cost of losing agency over the way you're building your character, go for it. But with the Souls games, don't ever feel pressured to min-max. There's no problem that can only be solved by optimizing your gear, your stats, your build, or whatever. Just be aware that if you aren't covering your weaknesses with gear, you're going to have to spend a lot more time and expend a lot more effort. The goal of the game, the way I see it, isn't to find ways around the challenge, it's to work through it. Latria, to recap, is the story of a vengeful husband banished by his queen who returned possessed by a demonic golden head wrap, who imprisons the citizens and nobles, sets an effigy of the queen up as a symbol of hope for those foolish enough to believe in the possibility of redemption, and those with hope venture forward and upwards and either pledge themselves to channeling souls into the heart, or they become experiments. They are turned either into gargoyles, or they are combined with creatures to become the man centipedes, or the prisoner hordes, the big masses of prisoners fused into a big ball. Or the Maneaters, who may have been the ultimate goal for the Golden Garb. I think that the Golden Garb was manipulating the monk into carrying out these experiments, so it would have a yet stronger vessel. The Maneaters pretty much look like hybrids between the man centipedes and the gargoyles. I also think the goal wasn't to have the two Maneaters, but a single Maneater with two souls. But the experiment never reached that point. There is a corpse behind Maneaters with two souls on it, and it's the only one like it in the whole game. So I think it was a failure to make a single unified Maneater that was much more powerful, or supposed to be, than the others. So with this cutscene, we are seeing the conclusion to the Latria story in action. And the banished man who came back with the golden garb sought the power to take revenge and foolishly thought that he could control the robe, but they, seeking a powerful vessel, controlled him, and the act of abandoning the weak, dying monk and fleeing to a new, stronger host is the robe's way of seeking its own power. And that is exactly what the cutscene shows us. Also, I wasn't actually just invaded by someone. Technically, this is a really, really unique boss fight. So the way the old monk fight works is that if you're playing online, there's a chance that the old monk can summon a player instead of the normal NPC boss. If you do this fight offline, then what happens is you fight a weak little black phantom, a generic enemy. It's not much in the way of a boss fight. He has a few very weak, very telegraphed attacks, like an uppercut. He has homing soul arrows. He can parry you and riposte. I believe he can also backstab you, and you have the same liberty against him. but it's not until you actually get to fight another player that you see how interesting this fight can really be. I had an hour and a half long fight against this particular player who got summoned to play against me. Another reason I'm kind of happy this wound up being a post-commentary episode, because when I did my first playthrough of this that I had captured originally, I did this in offline mode. This is one of the few cases throughout this Let's Play I've been happy to be invaded. I was happy to be invaded. So here are two things to keep in mind with this fight. The Black Phantom, the player controlling the monk, can wait right by the fog gate to backstab you as soon as you enter, unlike a normal boss, which stays in a fixed position in the arena. So when you enter the room, immediately roll. They can also cast any of their AoEs like Wrath of God and Firestorm by the door and hit you through it and kill you before you enter the room. And you can do the same thing to them, though you normally won't kill them. So I actually have a theory about the old monk and that relates to the beating heart. And I think it's that the beating heart was being powered by the souls of the prisoners in 3-2. And it was not only to further the experiments to create new demons, you know, the hybrids. I'm thinking that it had the secondary purpose of sustaining the old monk's life. And after we sever its connection to the prisoner's souls, the old monk can no longer go on living. And in the time it takes for us to beat the Maneaters and climb the tower, the last remnants of life have finally crept out of the old man. And its host, the Golden Garb, picks a new host at that point. And one of the more annoying things about doing this fight online is because of latency, it looks like you should not be in a position to be backstabbed, but sometimes you just get backstabbed. The thing on his head, the golden shawl that wraps up in a big tornado pattern on his head, is an item that you can actually get. The fact that you see it on him doesn't necessarily mean that the Phantom is using it, but it is something that you can get. If you play as the boss and you kill the If you kill the player as the boss, you actually get the item. And it's a pretty neat item. It works a lot like the Ring of Magical Sharpness or the Silver Braces, in that you get a magic damage increase, but you also drop magic defense. It makes for a pretty handy item if you're a caster, otherwise not so much. So yeah, I've decided to break my hour and a half fight up against this guy into a little highlight reel. Just trying different tactics to make this work and sighing as they fail. The reason this fight went so ungodly long is because both of us brought a ton of healing items to the table. And we were both hellbent on winning. I was just a little more hellbent on winning, though. So the thing is, I feel like the boss gets a little bit of an advantage when he heals, because it seems like he gets, from what you can see, he gets invincibility frames when he heals. I don't have that same benefit. We both burn through a fuck ton of healing items throughout the course of this fight. He had a few moments where he got me pretty low, and I had a lot of moments where I got him low, but we would both just find a moment to heal and reset the situation. It kept going like that for a very, very, very long time. And it was kind of fun for about half of that. Because having to find new ways to figure out how to deal with this guy was fun and all, and figuring out, how to adjust your style was nice, but you might imagine that an hour and a half duel might get super, super tedious. So at this point, it looks like I was trying to roll around, or I mean to roll and do the R1 attack with the DBS, which is that 180 degree AoE swipe attack that drags the sword along the ground. This was a painstaking fight. It's the big downside to doing this fight online, in that The monk offline, the old monk, can heal, but he does so very rarely by comparison. You usually have to back off and really leave him alone at low health. And even then, it's a little bit rare for him. It's a little bit rare to see. So the old monk's soul is used for four different things. If you want to platinum the game, you have to do at least four playthroughs or dupe the souls, which is an exploit I'm not going to tell you how to do, but there are plenty of tutorials online. You need his soul for the insanity catalyst, which is a catalyst wrapped in the golden garb, and it's the best catalyst in the game. You need it for the homing soul arrow spell, which you can see him using it. You also need his soul for Banish and Soulthirst, and he is, I think, one of two bosses that has that many uses for a soul. And that's why if you're platinuming the game, you need to play through the game four times.
Fighters ready. Engage.
And ultimately, this is how the fight was decided. Good old-fashioned gentlemanly fisticuffs. You can do everything with your fists that you can normally do with a weapon equipped. You can parry and riposte, you can backstab. The kick attack that breaks enemies' guards and causes them to stumble backwards, it becomes a headbutt. And I think he does it to me a couple times. I want to see the headbutt happen. And it really shocks me that this is how he let this fight go down. Of course, I was not about to sacrifice all this time and effort by having him heal up. So at the last minute, what I decided to do was to bust out the fireball spell and make sure that he could not heal. Because I was worried that what he was going to do was he was going to let me punch him to like 1/1000th of a percent of health and then just heal up like it's nothing, because fists don't do shit for damage and there's no way I could have caught up with him. And with that out of the way, that's Tower of Lotchery done. Thanks for watching, guys. Take it easy. Have a good one.